Perfect. So this is what I'm going to do. So this is what I'm going to do. This is the agenda for the session today. I'm going to divide the session into three phases. Okay. And in the three phases, I'm going to discuss what would be the prep phase, what would be the advanced phase, and what would be the mid phase. Okay. So we can have a discussion on that. Just okay, guys, you can start typing your answers in the chat window quickly. All right. Now, again, why I've chosen to use this question is because, again, this question, you know, helped me with the take back, right? See, the question says H of N is defined as the product of all even integers from 2 to N. So basically, it's 2 into 4 into 6 into 8 till N, right? If P is the smallest prime factor of H of 100 plus 1, then P is what? So the first thing I'm going to do is to find out what is H of 100. So H of 100 is going to be 2 into 4 into 6 into 8 till 100. Right? I'm going to simplify this. H of 100 is going to be, I'm going to take 2. I can take 2 common out of all of these terms. Remember, guys, if it's 2 into 4 into 6 into 8 into 10 till 100, there's going to be 50 terms. So I can pull out a 2 common from all of these 50 terms. So the value I pull out common is going to be 2 to the power of 50. And what I'm left out with will be 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 till 50. I'm basically simplifying this entire product. So H of 100 is going to be 2 to the power of 50 into 50 factorial. So this is how I work for H of 100. But remember, the question is asking me, if P is the smallest prime factor of H of 100 plus 1. Now think about this, okay? What do you think would be the prime factor? What would be the greatest prime factor of H of 100? You have H of 100 as 2 to the power of 50 into 50 factorial. What would be the greatest prime factor of H of 100? What would be the greatest prime number that divides this product? Akshita, 2 into 50 factorial is not the prime, right? What is the greatest prime number that divides this product? Piyush, can you give me the exact value? What will be the greatest prime that divides this entire product? 49 is not prime, Aditya. 1 is not prime, Aniket. 47, perfect. I know that the greatest prime factor of 2 to the power of 50 into 50, 2 to the power of 50 into 50 factorial is going to be 47, because I know that 50 factorial will be perfectly divisible by 47, right? Because 50 factorial is 50 into 49 into 48 into 47. So 47 would get canceled. So I know the greatest prime factor that H of 100 can have is 47. And the question is asking me, if P is the smallest prime factor of H of 100 plus 1. Now think about it very logically, right? This is H of 100. And this is H of 100 plus 1. Basically, what they're giving me is two numbers which are next to each other on the number line, right? H of 100 is 2 to the power of 15 to 50 factorial. and h of 100 plus 1 is 2 to the power of 15 to 50 factorial plus 1. These two are numbers which are numbers next to each other on the number line. And remember, numbers next to each other on the number line can never share a factor, can never share a factor other than 1. So these two numbers, right? Take an example, for example, 2 and 3. 2 and 3 can never share a factor other than 1, because the factors of 2 are 1 and 2, the factors of 3 are 1 and 3. So they can only share a factor of 1. So if I know 47 is the prime number that divides 2 to the power of 15 into 50 factorial, the number that is going to divide h of 100 plus 1 has to be a number which is greater than 47. So the only logical pick here would be echo. Now, what is the conceptual take back here? Now, the conceptual take back here is the concept of coprime. Somebody already mentioned it. And this is where, you know, the GMAT would test you on really, really, really obscure concepts, right? It's the concept of coprimes. Now, what are coprimes? Now, don't go by the name and say coprimes and have two prime numbers next to each other. Okay, that doesn't work. Coprimes are basically two numbers, for example, 4 and 9, which share a factor of only 1. Or two numbers which have an HCF, the highest common factor, to be 1. See, the factors of 2 are 1, 2, and factors of 4 are 1, 2, and 4. And the factors of 9 are 1, 3, and 9. The only factor that 4 and 9 share is 1, right? And that's when you call two numbers coprimes. So that's the definition of a coprime. And now what is the application of a coprime? Now you've learned what a coprime is. Now where can a coprime be used? Can anybody tell me where can a coprime be used? Where do we use this concept of coprimes? We use the concept of coprimes for the tests of divisibility. Most of y'all would know what the test of divisibility for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and so on would be, right? Up to 11. But what if I ask you, what should be the divisibility rule for a number to be divided by 12? What should be the divisibility rule for 12? Anybody? Can anybody here quickly tell me what should be the divisibility rule for 12? Why 3 and 4, Ved? Why not 6 and 2? See, most of you are telling me 3 and 4, right? Perfect. Now, the reason why we say that for a number to be divisible by 12, the number has to be divisible by 3 and to be divisible by 4 is because we use the concept of coprimes here. For any number beyond 11, if you need to find a divisibility rule, all you have to do is break down that number as a product of its coprimes, right? Let me take another example. Let's take 18, right? If you're asked to find out what is the divisibility rule for 18, then you're going to split it up as 2 and 9 and not 6 and 3, because 2 and 9 are coprimes to each other. So this concept of coprimes is used in the concept of divisibility. All right. So you see how one thing led to another? You see how one thing led to another? And just by using this question, I got to know what coprimes are. And then I figured out, okay, the divisibility rules is based on coprimes. Now that is what you need to identify in questions, right? Don't make sure you solve the question and just get to an answer and leave it there. Try to see if there's something else that you can take away from this question. Okay. And that's what you'll have to do in your second phase of prep. Whenever you know, practice questions, don't practice questions just for seeing what question is, what answer choice is right and what is wrong. All right. Perfect. Sumit, the smallest prime factor has to be greater than 47, because h of 100 and h of 100 plus 1 will never share a prime factor, right? So all the factors of h of 100 and all the factors of h of 100 plus 1 are different. And I know 47 is going to be a factor of h of 100, right? So h of 100 plus 1 should have a factor which is way different than 47. And that would be definitely greater than 47 in that case. Take an example, right? 4 and 9. Just look for a pattern there. See, 1, 2, and 4. Isn't it? And here you're going to get 1, 3, and 9. You see, the factors are completely different except for 1. So if I'm telling you that h of 100 is going to have, you know, all factors and one of the factors is 47, h of 100 plus 1 should have all factors different to h of 100 except for 1. So I know the value has to be a value greater than 47. Okay, guys, so I made my point on the fact that when you're working with questions, make sure you do an in-depth analysis and learn new concepts, okay, on what the questions test you on. Perfect. Now, why don't you try this question also? That's the last question before I go into phase three. And phase three will make more sense for people who are in the advanced stage of their prep. Okay. So, guys, one more question. And I want to make a point here on how exactly you maintain an error log and how exactly you take back questions from the official guide again. Okay. So, again, this is a quantitative review question. I'm going to give you 2 minutes. Your time starts now. Another 30 seconds. Okay, now, the reason again why I've put this question is because this question, helped me create a process to solve questions based on circles, okay? And till date, I still use the same process and it helps me out on all questions with circles, okay? And this is what I normally would teach in the classroom session on the online session. I made this point and I make this point to every student. Now, the thing with geometry, right, and the GMAT is very tricky that way, is they don't want to test you on your grasp of the concepts, right? Your in-depth grasp on really, weird properties of circles and triangles. They just test you on very basic properties of circles and very basic properties of triangles. In fact, most of your questions would test you on the fact that the sum of all interior angles in a triangle would add up to 180. In fact, this question tests you exactly on that. Now, what happened when I first solved this question? I went the long route, got to the answer. But when I reviewed it, right? And this is what I made as a side note in the note that I had on working procedures for particular questions. I made a note which has always served me very, very well. Whenever you deal with questions on circles, always look for the radii. The radii are like your friend. Okay, they're always going to give you a working procedure to follow. And after you look for the radii, you identify the isosceles or the equilateral triangles. This is exactly what I had put down in my set of notes when I was solving geometry, especially with circles. And I've held on to this till date, and it's always helped me out. I'll show you how this would help you out. Okay, so I'm going to work with the diagram given to me. The first thing I would do is I would identify the radii. Now I know OA and OB are the radii. Even before looking at the question, right? I know that O is the center. So OA and OB are the radii. That makes triangle OAB isosceles. And that makes angle A, let me put it this way, angle BAO equal to angle ABO. And now I'm going to work with the information given in the question stem. They're telling me OC is equal to AC is equal to AB. They've given me even more isosceles triangles. So OCA is isosceles, ACB is isosceles, and my third hidden isosceles triangle is OAB. Now I'm going to work with the isosceles triangles. If this angle is X, this angle is also going to be X. Because the sides are equal, the base angles have to be the same. And this angle C has to be 180 minus 2x. If this angle C is 180 minus 2x, this portion of the angle C has to be 2x. And if this angle C is 2x, angle B is also going to be 2x because ABC is isosceles. And that would make angle BAC as 180 minus 4x. So I basically boiled this entire question down. I'm going to redraw it so that you understand what I'm doing. Right? So O is the center. This, 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 and this. I know this is equal to this is equal to this. So this is given to me as X. So this is X. This is 180 minus 2X. This will be 2X. This will be 2X. And this is going to be 180 minus 4X. And now this is where I take into consideration the outer isosceles triangle. Now look at the outer isosceles triangle OAB. I know angle BAO. Now this is angle BAO. And angle BAO is going to be X plus 180 minus 4X. Is equal to angle ABO, and ABO is 2x. I can clearly solve for x here because 180 is going to be equal to 5x. X is going to be equal to 36 degrees. So this is the working procedure that you can always follow whenever you encounter a circle question with triangles. Always look for the radii. And after you look for the radii, always identify the isosceles triangles or equilateral triangles. It'll always help you out. Okay, and these are the kinds of notes and these are the kind of take back that you need to take from every question, right? And you need to make those small working procedures towards the side of your book or maintain a separate book for that because it's going to help you on test day. Okay with this, guys? All of you all okay with this? Perfect. Okay, so let's get back to the slide again. Let's go to phase three. Now, once you completed with the official guide, my advice would be to start with the quantitative review and the verbal review. Now, when you work with the quant review and the verbal review, the best thing to do is to always solve these questions in the timed practice. Okay. So what I would normally suggest is for you to select 31 questions from the quant review and select 36 questions from the verbal review and solve it in a time frame of 62 minutes in quant and 65 minutes on verbal. And how would I select the 31 questions? I would select 15 questions from problem solving, 16 questions from data sufficiency or vice versa. And for verbal, I would select 9 questions or 12 questions from sentence correction, 12 questions from critical reasoning, and I would choose approximately 4 RC passages. And I would make a set of questions, okay? I would make a set of questions and I would use those questions and solve it in a time frame. Now, what happens in the final lap is your focus has to shift from accuracy, right? Now, instead of accuracy, your focus should be, okay, how do I try to manage both time as well as be, you know, as accurate as possible on a particular question? So the timing practice should be done on the quant review as well as the verbal review. Okay. Yes, Siddharth, when I talk about the quant review and the verbal review, they are the official review books. Okay. They are called the quantitative review and the verbal review. Right. Now, the second thing you need to do is, for those who are already at a good 48, 49 on quant, the second thing you have to do is you quickly have to start using advanced material, advanced questions for both quant and verbal, right? So one way is you can always get some advanced quant questions from the advanced documents we provide. The other resource that you can make use of is on GMAT Club. You have huge treasure. It's a treasure trove of questions on quant especially. And you can also use the advanced GMAT quant from the Manhattan GMAT, right? Which gives you a good set of hard quant questions that will, you know, at least push you to that level of a 50 over 51. Now for verbal, you have to be a little careful here. If you're looking at advanced questions, then my advice would be to stick to the advanced documents that we provide. And this is for all our students. Stick to the advanced documents we provide. You have approximately 400 SC questions, 200 CR questions, and approximately 70 RC passages. In addition to that, if you want some more practice, then you can definitely purchase the GMAT question pack, right, from the MBA.com website. That gives you a good set of 404 questions to practice on. And remember, official questions means they actually retired GMAT questions. I've appeared on GMAT tests before, all right? And at this point of time is when you take up the tests from test pack 1 and test pack 2. So this is how you need, and this is how the people, for those are people in the advanced phase of prep, right? You need to phase out your prep. My advice is to take 1 month of preparation. You have 4 tests, the 4 official prep tests from test pack 1 and test pack 2. I would recommend that you phase out these 4 tests over the 4 weekends in the last month. So you review your concepts, say on Monday. That would be the first day of the week. You review all the concepts of quant and verbal. You do timed practice from the quantitative review, from the advanced documents and the verbal review. And you do the timed practice on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Saturday should be a day dedicated to the entire review of all the questions that you've solved. And Sunday should be the time that you take up a practice test. Okay. And once you take up a practice test, take it in the morning. The remaining portion of the day should be spent to review all the questions in the practice test. And again, don't review only the questions that you've got wrong. I would recommend that you review the questions that you've got right. Yes, test pack 1 will have GMAT prep 3 and 4, Ria, and test pack 2 will have GMAT prep 5 and 6. Question breakup for quant, Shubham, would be 15 questions for problem solving, 16 for data sufficiency. I would recommend that you take approximately 8 questions from arithmetic, 8 from algebra, 8 from geometry, and 8 from stats. No, Tina, the quant review is not going to contain topic-wise question, and I wouldn't want you to solve it also in a topic-wise way, because now you're doing timed practice, right? So when you're doing timed practice, you need to take questions of which deal with various concepts, because it helps you tune your mind to juggle between different concepts, okay? So never solve quant review and advanced documents questions based on the question type, okay? Always do it in a mixed bag of sorts. All right. Any questions at this point, guys? Akshita, it's a question that it's very vague, right? Would you ask me what would I prefer? What would I advise to follow? See, the best thing to do is for you to determine this yourself, right? What we tell our students is you take up one practice test where you start with the verbal section, then go to quant, and take up one practice test where you start with quant and then go to verbal. Okay. And you try to evaluate which of these two, which one of the two tests that you were more comfortable with, right? Because there are two sources of thought here. One set of students say that they would want to take the verbal section first because they are, you know, their mind is relatively fresh. There's another source of thought which says that you're prone to making errors. You're prone to making errors when you start the test. So it's better, it's more safer to take the quant section. And when you go to the verbal section, you're in your peak zone of concentration. Okay. All right. The time wait that you need to spend on phase two would be approximately five weeks time, right? I would say 4 to 5 weeks time is what you'll have to work on phase two, because that's going to be the heavy lifting that you're going to do, right? You're going to learn the concept. You're going to work questions based on that concept. You're going to work questions on the official guide. So it's going to take you a lot more time than phase one and phase three. Amik, we provide the test pack one and test pack two to students, the classroom students, because we have a lab here. For online students, we give them an opportunity to connect with us over TeamViewer, and you would take access of the test pack one and test pack two. You would take access of a system here in our lab, which has those two test packs, installed. Okay. Bharti, I didn't get your question. If you are 2 months off taking exam, how should be the prep? So I think you're in the phase two of preparation, right? So phase two of preparation would be for you to do conceptual wise learning of topics and then working questions from the OG. Okay, you should focus on getting all the concepts in place. Yes. So there's two things that you can do here, Bharti. One is you can do quant for maybe an hour and a half in the morning, verbal maybe in the evening, or vice versa. Some other people follow an alternate strategy. They take quant first on Monday and then verbal on Tuesday and then alternate like that. My recommendation would be take 1 hour of verbal in the morning and 1 hour of quant in the evening. Yes, Sri, your phase two is to complete all the questions from the official guide and take up your second practice test. Okay, phase two, the end result is for you to finish the official guide and to take up your second practice test. Now that score of that practice test is what you'll have to critically analyze, because that's going to tell you how much of more time you require to, you know, push your score to what score you're looking at. Yes, Wade, it's going to be 3 weeks each. You can crunch it for 2 weeks. I told you that depends upon your work schedule, right? It's going to be different for everybody else. So I would recommend 3 weeks if you're able to put only 90 minutes. If you're able to put in 2 hours or 2.5 hours of work every day, you can crunch that to 2 weeks. Yeah. Apoorv, you can connect with us by sending an email to prep@crackverbal. You can also connect with us on the prep number that you're provided, right? You'll have the number in the study plan that is given. See, Anisha, if your answer accuracy is not increasing in the OG, right, then your review process has to be very, very important. So either there are two things which are a problem. You're not reviewing the questions carefully. You're making the mistakes all over again. You're not taking back things from the review. Or there are some problems in your conceptual understanding. Okay. So it's better for you to revisit the concepts or improve on the review processes. Yes, Bharati. So if you've already finished the OG, right, for verbal, I wouldn't suggest for you to do it again because you'll be biased towards the answers. It's better for you to take up the verbal review. If you're done with the verbal review, then you always have the advanced documents, right? You can download the questions from the retired GMAT folder of the advanced documents. You can make use of it. Yes, Aniket. So I'm going to, in this chat window, right, at the end of the session, I'm going to post, I'm going to give you the link, a Dropbox link to all the study plans and also the homework sheets, right? And it'll also give you the verbal basic PDF you can make use of. Yes, Sandeep. So what exactly is your question on that? Are you giving me an information or are you asking me something about the quant course? Okay, Navandeep, that's a good question you've asked, right? Where can we get more practice tests other than pack one and pack two? See guys, six practice tests should suffice, okay? Two free ones and four paid ones. Official tests are the way to go because they are as close to the actual GMAT as possible. But if you're a person who's a retaker, or if you're a person who's already exhausted the test but needs more tests to practice, right? Then again, trusted resources would be the Veritas prep test and as well as the Manhattan GMAT prep test. But this only if after you've completed all the six practice tests of GMAC, okay? Only if you've exhausted the official material, I would ask you to go to alternate resources. I'll tell you the problem with going to alternate resources. If you take up the Manhattan test, very, very, very good resource for quant, especially for people looking to score a 50-51 on quant. The questions there are much harder than what you're going to get on the actual test in the quant section. But the verbal section, no test prep company does justice to the verbal section as what the GMAT prep does. Okay, they do a very good job, Manhattan and Veritas, but the verbal section is a little iffy and it's going to be slightly different than what you're going to find on actual test day. Okay. So it's a trusted resource, but I would only recommend that after you finish the six practice tests from GMAC. Yes, Indresh, the questions will repeat because there is a limited pool of questions. Okay. Okay, guys. Now, this is what you'll need to do when you're analyzing questions from the practice test. Like I said, right, you need to take practice tests at every 1 week interval. So no, Piyush, the repetition will be more, okay, because test pack one and test pack two have a pool of approximately 200 questions. I would say test pack the free tests has a bigger pool, but test pack one and test pack two will have a smaller pool. And it's never a good thing to take the tests again and again, no, because it's never going to give you a proper score that what you can expect on test day. It's always going to give you an inflated score, isn't it? No, you can reset the test pack and use it how many ever times you want, Siddharth. The free basic quant and verbal videos in there is given to all our students who have enrolled with us, right? We don't provide it to other students. So you can purchase it separately if you want on the Crackverbal website. Okay. So we give it free to all our students, but I'm going to send you the verbal basics PDF. Okay. You can make use of that. Unfortunately, we don't have a quant basic PDF because all the questions are on video form. Okay. So the verbal basic PDF should help you out in the link that I'm sending you. Okay, guys. Now this is for anybody who's in your last phase of prep, right? I'm going to skip that previous question because we're running short of time, but there's one thing that you'll have to always, always hold on to here is you'll always have to make your mistakes count. In a sense, if you've fallen for a trap on a question, you should make a note of it and make sure that you cross-check for that trap when you solve other questions, okay? Never forget the types of mistakes you've made. It's like this, right? Once you burn your fingers, you're not going to, you know, put your fingers into the fire all over again, right? So just make sure that whatever mistakes you make it count really, 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 really well. Okay. So I'm going to give you another question here. A very good question. Huge pieces of take back. I want you to take 2 minutes and give me an answer for this, please. I'm coming to that, Bharti. I'll come into that. I'll show you how exactly you maintain error log. Yes, Sandeep. So the purpose of the session, right? I didn't want to keep it only a session where I discuss about the processes of, you know, how to go about your prep. I wanted to put it with examples, right? So the best thing for me to do is to, instead of just making a statement that this is what you can do, is to actually show it to you by a couple of examples. Okay. That's why I wanted to introduce a couple of questions here. anonymous, two pieces of material that I would suggest for brushing up your basics of quant. One is please use the foundations of GMAT quant from Manhattan, okay? And you can always also access our quant basic videos on our website. Also, you can have a look at some preview videos if you want. We have approximately 13 hours of video which takes care of all the basics of quant. Okay, and this is not in addition to the actual course. Okay, it's 13 hours of basics videos only. So if you're a person who's very weak at quant, then that would make more sense. Another thing that you can do, but it's a long roundabout procedure, is for you to go back to your 10 standard books, right, and make use of the NCRT books. But that would take just too much of time to work with, and it's going to give you a lot of extra things other than what the GMAT tests you. So stick to the Manhattan GMAT foundations book. Okay. Ved, I'm sending you the verbal basic PDF at the end of the session. We don't have videos specifically for it, but we do have the PDF. Okay, guys, another 30 seconds. Quickly, type in your answers in the chat window. Okay, so let's have a discussion on this. And this is a fantastic question that that makes you fall for a couple of traps and makes you learn from these traps. Okay, I will do that, Piyush. I'll summarize everything right now. X square y plus xy plus xy square is greater than, I'm opening the brackets here, xy plus xy square. Right? I'm going to simplify this. I can cancel out the xy and I can cancel out the xy square. So the question is just asking me, is x square y greater than 0? Right? That's what the question is. Now, most of y'all have given me the answer as A. Why can't I cancel xy and xy square on both sides, Piyush? It doesn't matter. It's an addition, not zero, right? It's not a multiplication. It's an addition, right? The rule of inequality states you can add or subtract anything on both sides of the inequality, and the inequality sign remains unchanged. It's only when you're submultiplying and dividing, you can't cancel both the values on both sides. Okay? So it's not, this is addition. So I can definitely cancel it on both sides. And basically what I'm doing, so what is there if it's negative, right? If I give you minus 3 is less than minus 2, if I add one on both sides, or let's subtract one on both sides, right? I'm going to get minus 4 is less than minus 3. The relationship doesn't change. You can add anything you want. You can subtract anything you want on both sides, whether it's positive or negative. You don't need to worry. Only when you multiply or divide, that's when you have to worry about the signs. Okay? So it's absolutely fine to cancel here because it's an addition. I don't need to worry about it. So I've boiled down the question to, is x square y greater than 0? Now, most of y'all have answered A, which is the clear trap answer. Some of y'all have not fallen for the trap, and that's a great sign. For those of y'all who gave me C as the answer here, that's a great sign. You guys are already, in the zone of your preparation. So you've taken back certain things from here. Now, for those of y'all who gave A, right, this is what you need to take back from this question. The first statement tells you y is greater than 0. Now, you'll have to check whether this piece of information is sufficient to answer the question. Now, most of you all would have said, if y is greater than 0, this becomes positive, and x square by default is positive, so x square y will always be greater than 0. What you've forgotten is that x square is not only positive, it can be 0 or positive. So if y is greater than 0, I know y is positive, but x square can also be 0. And if x square is 0, 0 into a positive value will give me 0. In that case, 0 is going to be greater than 0. And that's going to disprove the entire first statement. So it's possible for me to get a yes when x square is positive. It's also possible for me to get a no when x square is equal to 0. So the first statement is clearly insufficient. So the biggest mistake that people make, right? And this is where you have to take back things from your mistakes. Never assume that a squared term, never assume that an even exponent term is always positive. An even exponent term is zero or positive, okay? Or the better way to represent an even exponent term is it's always non-negative. That's the better way to represent things, okay? So the first trap is for you to assume that x squared is always going to be positive. So the first statement was clearly not sufficient. The second statement tells you xy is greater than zero. Now, if xy is greater than zero, I know that both x and y can be of the same sign. But if x and y are, say, both positive, then I know x squared y will definitely be greater than zero. But if x and y are both negative, then I know that y is going to be negative, x square y will be less than zero. So clearly the second statement is also insufficient. Now, when I combine the two, when I see the first statement tells me y is greater than zero, and the second statement tells me xy is greater than zero, here you'll realize that the only possible values that x can take are positive or negative. So the value of x cannot be zero because it has to satisfy the second statement. So the value of x cannot be zero. That will always make x square positive. And from the first statement, we already have y to be positive. So positive into positive will always give me a value greater than zero. The answer here is Charlie. Got it? So the trap here lay in the fact that most of y'all would have assumed that x square is always going to be positive, right? But x square can also be zero here, right? So an even exponent term is always going to be non-negative. That should be your take back. And that is a common mistake that test takers will make, right? So you should take back something from this. And whenever you see now a squared term, you should always think, okay, it can be zero or positive. Okay with this, guys? All of y'all? Perfect. Okay, so somebody asked for a summary of what needs to be done. So I'm going to give you that summary. Let me shift to the screen. Okay. Now let me make a column here and tell you what you need to do in phase one, phase two, and phase three, right? So phase one. Says phase one, research on colleges that you want to apply to. Take a GMAT prep diagnostic. Use official resources. Fourth, purchase the test packs, the GMAT prep test packs. This should be phase one, and inclusive of phase one, brush up the basics of quant, basics. Most important, brush up basics of both quant and verbal. This is what you'll have to do in phase one, right? Now phase two, learn concepts, solve questions from the OG, right? Focus on accuracy and not time, right? This should be approximately for a time frame of 4 to 6 weeks, okay? Your phase two. And at the end, take GMAT practice test two. This is what you'll have to do in phase two. Right, and you'll have to analyze the score. Now, based on the analysis of the score, you move on to phase three. Phase three would be focused prep on concepts, on specific concepts. Second, test every weekend. Remember to review those tests also. Make sure you solve questions from the advanced documents or advanced questions. Right? Revise all the concepts on a weekly basis. Right? And finally, decide on when to book the test date. Now, what is the ideal time to book the test date? As soon as you get two practice tests, which are approximately the same, which are approximately of the same score and very close to what the ideal score you're looking at, I would go ahead and book the test date at least a week or two from that specific date I've taken the test. Okay. The advanced docs, yes, they do contain some questions from exam pack 3 and exam pack 4, Piyush. All right. Okay, guys, so this is how you phase out your prep. I'm not putting a time frame on phase 1 and phase 3 because that would depend upon, you know, every person to person, right? Phase 2 is the one that I would say for 4 to 6 weeks. Phase 1, some people can just, finish off phase 1 in like a week or so, take up a diagnostic, brush up on all the concepts and, research on the colleges. Some people might take, say, 2 weeks or 3 weeks because they have to do an in-depth analysis on the basics of quant and verbal. Okay. I would use VR and QR in phase 3 Ved. Okay. And I would do it in terms of timed practice. Okay. Timed practice. Advanced documents, I wouldn't exhaust everything. Okay. So I would use the advanced documents in a very smart way where I only pick and choose the topics that I want to work from. See, Sandeep, the problem with the Indian B school, right, is your score has to be, for IIMs, I would say in the average score is around 710, 720. For ISB, you'll need something in the late 600s, early 700s. Okay. So it's imperative that you have something in that range if you're looking at those three universities. See, Ved, it depends. I told you, it depends on student to student, right? If you're able to put 3 hours of work per day, then you can do the VR and QR in parallel with your sentence correction, right? If you're not able to put that 3 hours of work per day, you're able to put only 1 hour in the morning and 1 hour in the evening, then it makes sense to work with VR and QR in phase 3 of your prep. So you decide how is your work schedule, right? If you're able to put around 3 to 4 hours of work per day, then I would definitely push the VR and QR into phase 2 and do it after working SC, CR and RC. No, Maithili, it's not a good idea to prepare for GMAT and CAT simultaneously because it's two different exams, right? Your GMAT verbal is going to be way tougher than your CAT verbal and your CAT quant is going to be way tougher than the GMAT quant. Ria, I'm sorry. I mean, the questions are just coming directly. So I think I missed out on your question. If you can type it again, I can answer to that. IR for anybody who has less than 5 years of work experience, right? We would definitely recommend it to take up two-year PGP. Anybody with more than 5 years of experience, we would definitely recommend you take a 1 year MBA. Syria, my advice would be in your case, always stick to the GMAT practice test. Okay. The Manhattan GMAT I told you, right, would be meant for students who have got a 48 or a 49 on quant on two continuous tests and looking to push to a 50. So my advice is stick to the official test for now. Yes, the score will be inflated for GMAT prep too, right? So Have you exhausted all the tests you're saying? I mean, this is the free test you're talking about or the paid tests? No, then you have you. Then I would recommend that you purchase the 4 paid tests, right? Because it gives you 4 more tests to work with. Does it make sense to take up a test again and get an inflated score? No, I would want to definitely put a number to what sort of prep I've done, isn't it? From GMAT prep test CT. You can get it on the MBA.com website. They are the official test pack 1 and test pack 2. You can send an email for the Jeff Sackman book and I can send it to you, right? No problem. You can send an email to prep@crackverbal and I can send it to you. Guys, for applications, my advice is for you to keep a buffer of approximately a month before the application process starts. Okay, so normally September, October, if you're the deadlines would start for most of the colleges. So it's better to leave the month of August, right, entirely to work on applications. Yes, more experience with slightly lesser score is acceptable, right? As long as your application is a little stronger than the others, that's absolutely fine. See, Maithili, you'll have to think about things carefully here, okay? If you're a person who wants to get into a middle management level, then the MIM will be a good option, very good option. If you're a person who's looking at, okay, let me continue what I'm doing here for another couple of years, right, and then take up the GMAT and go to an MBA, do an MBA, then it's going to be a jump to an upper management level position, okay? So you'll have to take a call on that because the MIM is for a middle management level role for that, I'm sure about. Apoor, like I said, right, it depends upon person to person. If you are able to put in that much of time to work with the VR and the QR in phase 2, I would definitely recommend that you do so. And then focus on the advanced documents on phase 3. No, conditional and Bayes theorem is not required in probability. See, you need to understand, Nidhi, that the what is tested in probability is very, say, real life scenario probability. Okay, so you don't have Bayes theorem as such at all. And if you're forced to use Bayes theorem, then your approach to the question is not in the correct way. Okay. Yes. So guys, this is the error log that I'm speaking about. I think most of you already have it. But I've also attached this in your Dropbox link. So a couple of people asked me for the error log. So this is how the error log looks. Okay. So you see, I've opened up the error log for the quant section. Hello. Yeah. So I've opened up the error log for the quant section here. If you look at it, we have created this error log for the official guide entirely. So it's a tracker sheets of sorts where if you make a mistake, all you have to do is, type in the answer here, right? And the correct answer is going to pop up on the right-hand side. And you have an option to flag the question, okay? You have an option to flag the question. So what you can do is after you solve the questions, right? After you solve approximately 40 to 50 questions from the official guide and the verbal review and the quant review, you can always, just do an analysis on the questions that you've got wrong, right? Take up all the ones you flagged and then you try to analyze that. Aniket, I'm going to send it to you. So for all of you all there, I'm going to send you the Dropbox link, guys. I'm going to send it in the chat window so you can download it from there. So it's a Dropbox link. This is what it is. And here you go. So everything that you need is in that Dropbox link, okay? I've just put it in the chat window. Guys, so like I was saying, the error log here is a tracker sheets of sorts, which helps you, flag the questions that you need to analyze. Okay. And definitely you can keep another sheet called notes and then make notes based on that. So the advantage here now is you look at this, we've already segregated the questions based on lessons and modules. So once you finish the entire problem solving section, right, it's going to give you the number of questions answered for each topic and the number of questions correct and the percentage correct. So you can go back to all of this and have a look at what are the specific topics you're having a problem at. So normally the probability portion and the algebra and equations portion, especially inequalities and absolute values, is where people normally find a lot of problems. Okay, so if you see that these two areas have lesser percentages of questions correct, right, then it's better to take the advanced documents because we've segregated the questions into categories and then use questions on probability and inequalities and absolute values there. And the same holds good for verbal. We have done it for RC, CR and SC. And we've also made a grid which counts how many questions you've answered and how many questions you've got correct with the accuracy rate. Okay, this is already attached in the Dropbox link, so you can download it from there. I've already sent it on the chat window, so I'm sending it again to you guys. Here it is. Guys, I've sent it again. Quickly download it. I've selected all, okay, 1 minute. Just a minute. Okay, so last points, guys. Remember, you'll also have to prepare for your AW and your IR sections, right? That should be maybe in your last 2 weeks of your prep. You touch upon AW and IR, and I would recommend that when you're taking a practice test, you don't skip the AW and the IR section even after you complete your quant and verbal sections, okay? It's better for you to work with the IR section because the questions there are, again, retired GMAT questions, so it would give you good practice to work with. In addition to that, we have two YouTube links here. You can go to our YouTube channel and you can access these two links for AW and IR. So for AW, we've given you a very good draft of an essay. And for integrated reasoning, we've explained the four question types along with an example each. Okay, so I want you guys can directly look this up on our YouTube channel. Right? And finally, these are the advanced quant and verbal resources that I would recommend for people in your last phase of prep. The advanced documents that we provide, the advanced GMAT quant for Manhattan GMAT, and the GMAT question pack that you can purchase from the MBA.com website. Okay. So quick last 5 minutes for some more questions before we wrap up with the session. I'll just give you one straightforward answer. I would prefer always to do an MBA from abroad. Okay. I'll tell you why, because it's a diverse set of people. I'll get to learn more the format. I mean, the way things would be put across, the teaching, it would be a little better compared to the IIMs. Okay. So I would definitely recommend that you do something from abroad. Oh, thank you, Nidhi. CT, you can always send an email to our marketing team. Okay. So marketing@crackverbal, if you want to, get some advice on what you need to do on your prep. So the marketing team normally routes them to the faculty. Okay. So you can just send a mail at marketing@crackverbal and then you can put in your doubt there. Okay. Avik, what I'll do is I'll request my marketing team to also, in the email that they send you after the webinar, to add this Dropbox link, okay, so that you'll have it there also to download. Ramya, MBA in Germany, iffy, I would say. I wouldn't think about that as an option, right? You do have a couple of good colleges, I would say, but MBA in Germany, I don't think would make sense for, especially if I'm looking at something post my MBA, right? I mean, I need to look at what I do post my MBA also, right? So I have to make the choice of the college in a very good way. Remember that in the universities abroad, and this is for somebody who asked me about IIMs and MBA, right? And colleges abroad. In the Indian colleges, you have some placement assistance, right? In colleges abroad, you'll have to do networking and you'll have to you know, try to get an internship at least after you finish your MBA. Okay. Yes, Ashwini, 2 years of experience is absolutely fine. Yes, CT. So what you can do, right? You can send in an email to a marketing team and request for a profile eval with one of our, you know, admission counselors. His name is Mr. Vijay or Ms. Srikala. She's our co-founder also, who can help you with that. Yes, I remember you, Nidhi. I remember you and Ritvik. You used to come to the Marathali Center, I remember. And you also came to the Koramangala Center for a couple of classes. Okay, so... All right. Okay. So I remember Ritvik very, very clearly. Okay, guys, any other question? Any other question before we wrap up? All right, so Apoorv, take any domain of MBA is absolutely fine. You don't need to worry. Now, I told you, right? You asking me this, I can't give you a direct answer because I don't know what your interests lie in, right? So it's better for you to figure it out rather than asking me what it is, right? If you want like a pure MBA, you don't need to worry about a semiconductor industry experience and go for a pure MBA. If you want to go to marketing, shift to marketing or finance, right? It would be hard, obviously, for you to suddenly take up a finance role. So maybe something like marketing would make sense. Productions and operations would make sense, right? It depends upon, what place outside India you're looking at. Right, you don't have US as the only option. In fact, I'm predicting more applicants to Canada and Singapore in the next 1 year. Siddharth, I'm so sorry. I have no clue about IESC for investment banking career. Right, if I knew something, I would have told you. But I'm just telling you directly. I've not researched on it. CT, that's two ways of looking at it. Okay. If my advice to you on this, I'll be again upfront. It's better for you to focus on your GMAT first, because once your GMAT score in place, you'll know how to draft your applications and you'll know what exact colleges you're going to apply to. Yes. IR in Singapore is going to be very less, but Canada is a better option that way, right? Because they are open to, taking on board more people, and getting a PR also in Canada is pretty easy. Akshita, Australia, I wouldn't think about an option for an MBA. I would have better options than Australia. But if you're particular about that, you can go. I don't think some of the colleges there will require an MBA. It will require a GMAT itself. Some of them will only accept an IELTS, I think. No, Ria, the question pack is a separate set of questions altogether. Anish, which colleges to be mentioned? Again, I told you, you'll have to do that research on your own. I can't randomly give you 5 colleges, right? Because I don't know what you're looking at. Inder, you can go to the colleges' websites itself, right? And look at the programs that they offer. Like somebody mentioned, you have something called an MIM program also. You have a particular program specific to certain aspects of an MBA for marketing and so on. Okay. I don't know the exact Australian University IELTS, but there are some of you, Australian University accept only IELTS. Okay. But I think it's not an option that you should consider, because the return on investment wouldn't be that great. All right, guys, then that's a wrap. We'll wrap up the session today. Like I said, right, in the study plan that is provided to you, there is a link sheet. There's a number. You can call up Mr. Vijay for a profile evaluation. And you can call up on the contact numbers, right, for application services. Please call up Vijay and see if you can get your profile evaluated. So all your questions on what colleges to apply for this course, for whatever course you're looking at, you know, Vijay would be the better person to give you an insight on. Okay. All right, guys. Good night. See you. Take care. Have a great weekend.